Thank you. All right. Now, thank you. Thank you very much. It's an absolute honor to be here. We're a small select group, so I think we can be as formal and informal as we want. So if I say something that doesn't compute immediately, just, you know, ask away. Today what I want to do is talk a little bit basically on the issue of Buddhist or Buddhist traditions in the plural, and topics of gender and sexuality, as how they, through diachronic and synchronic flows, developed, change, transform through time and space. But before we talk about this kind of particular kind of value productions, maybe we need to recall, when we talk about Buddhists, Buddhisms in the plural, that most Buddhist traditions approach the issue of ethics through what we could call philosophically a virtue ethics approach. So that's an approach that is normally connected with the Aristotelian approach to ethics, and it means that instead of preset essentializing norms, the contextuality of the ethical acting is always taken into consideration according to the parameters of idealist goals rather than idealist actions. So for instance, the typical approach would be to see in Buddhist, you would have virtues such as loving kindness or compassion, and then you would find that as a parameter for acting that is contextualized and situational. It's not situation ethics, it's not normative ethics, it's virtue ethics. And when we look at the production of values that come from this general approach to human interaction, then today I want to really focus on the issue of gendering human beings, gender equality versus inequality, sexual issues, and gender identity issues. Now, the first thing what we need to remind ourselves of is that there is a multiplicity and multivocality of Buddhist voices. So I want to start more as a philologian and as a historian walking you through some mainstream issues. Be always aware that Buddhism is not a monolithic thing, but it's been changing both temporally and spatially. But when we look at core issues of the message of Buddhism, then we find a very strong voice towards gender equality. However, this gender equality or gender differences as being a non-issue with respect to the human potential to realize enlightenment is on a philosophical level what we could call soteriology. So it is concerned to, you could say, the metaphysics of Buddhism. If we go into the sociology of Buddhism, then we have, or the practical level of Buddhism, then we find through most Buddhist traditions expressions and performances of inequality and discrimination. And so the parameters in which Buddhist traditions unfold are the South Asian traditions regarding to sex and gender sexualities that are overarching particularly Buddhist approach. And here we need to first of all understand that in pre-modern, pre-colonial South Asia, there is no distinction between sex on the one hand as an anatomical and biological category and gender on the other hand, which is a cultural produced category. There's also no pre-colonial essentialization of sexual behavior in terms of identity. Rather, there is a description of sexual behavior as things that people do rather than that people are. So that we know in modern and postmodern identity politics, categorize people according to what they like to do sexually or to whom they are attractive is something that we do not find reflected in pre-modern South Asian contexts. Then, another interesting fact on South Asian or South Asian parameter is that while we have in the Greco-Roman tradition the emergence of a rather stiff, essentialized binary of genders, male and female, we have from early Vedic times onwards a third gender or third sex attested that Buddhist and medical texts then evolve into a quatronomy, so a fourfold structure of categorization. So we have a male, female, neither nor male, and or female, and both male and female, and that is according to a certain philosophical logical step that most famously is used in Nagarjuna's philosophy, the Chushkoti. I'm not going to talk about that so much, but we need to keep that in mind. However, that is a philosophical parameter. Again, on the sociological parameter, the binaries of male and female are existing and are being heteropatriarchally enforced. Okay, so that is one. It's nice that the categories are there fourfold, but the social reality doesn't really play much, do much with it. Except for certain niches, we might or might not talk about that. And finally, one parameter to understand on South Asia, Asian philosophical parameter, is the view also attested from the Vedic texts onwards through the South Asian traditions, the view on non-male sexualities. We have in the global north often a view of male sexuality, that is what is very aggressive, very hegemonizing, very predatory. And it's interesting to understand that in South Asia, this has been switched around, and that female sexuality, a non-male sexuality, also panda cub sexuality, intersex sexuality, has been depicted as aggressive and predatory. And that has to do with a certain category also in philosophy that we find in expressed, for instance, in classical Sankhya philosophy, where the female principle is seen to be active yet unconscious, while the male principle is inactive and rational and conscious. So let's keep these parameters in mind. Now, if we look at gender equality, gender inequality, then coming from these parameters, we find the tension between the soteriology and the sociology, the tension between the equality in the potential and the inequality in the actualization of the systemic misogyny and androcentrism. So if we talk about Buddhist traditions on looking at what has been called the Nibbanic orientation or Nirvanic orientation, Sanskritically, then enlightenment experience is described as being beyond male and female, actually beyond anything that could be identitarian terms be essentialized. If we then look, however, to the samsaric orientation, or the social orientation, then we find an abundance of gendered imageries, heteropatriarchal imageries and of hegemonic masculinity and femininity in the different dharmic discourses. Famously in the Pali canon, the Buddha is very often called a bull of a man, which is a hyper-masculine description for the Buddha Shakyamuni, or as Pao showed in his book, or if you look at Onuma's book on the Buddhist family, we see that the depiction of female figures in Buddhist narratives always are used to project an image of a nuclear of the nuclear family, or that what feminist theories have called the myth of the heterosexual nuclear family. So, so the maternity being a very important parameter for the depiction of gendered female image narrative figures. So, in order to get to grips with these contradictory and tensional approaches to male and female, to gender in Buddhism, Alan Sponberg talked about a dialectic that goes from on the soteriology, where everything is included, to the reality, where in the institution we have androcentrism and we have what he calls ascetic misogyny as a historical remnant of the Shramana movement, out of which Buddhism makes a part, and out of which it grew. And then he suggests that especially late innate Buddhism and in Tantric Buddhism, this has been then, and in certain forms of Mahayana Buddhism, has been this tension and dialectic has been resolved into some sort of soteriological androgyny. So the idea that practitioners actually would then consciously engage in practices, especially tantric or esoteric practices, that would transcend their own gendered identities and use the stiffness of the societal gender system as something to work with in order to blow concepts in their own mind, in their own practice, on the way towards realizing enlightenment. This is an idealized approach by Sponberg, which works for most parts, but not actually, it's not that simple, because very often the tensions will not be dialectically resolved, but will simply exist next to each other, and people use all sort of avoidances in order to negotiate their own positions and the values these positions produce. Now let's have a look at a text that clearly talks about gender equality, and I won't go into this in detail, but the important here is the last verse, yassa ita disam yana mitya purissassa vasa ve etena yanena nibbana seva santike. So whatever vehicle is used by a man or a woman, it is the same. It is the same tool, it's the same vehicle which they've utilized to realize nirvana, or here arrive in nirvana. So there is no difference in practice, in soteriological practice. And that's a core text of the Samyutta Nikaya, of the Sutta Pitaka of the Pali canon. However, as we know, females seen as irrational, uncontrolled in their sexualities in Indian, South Asian cultural practices, when Buddhism institutionalized, or in Weberian terms routinized, obviously there was a problem to contextualize monasticism with these kind of ideas about gender. And so it led to the establishment of rather strict monastic orders that had strict governances towards the interaction of the genders, and also to some troubles in the establishment of non-orders who faced male opposition. As you know, the Buddha only allowed the establishment of the non-order through the intervention of Ananda on the request of his stepmother Mahaprajapati. So, and when the non-order was established, the South Asian androcentric, misogynic cultural context reasserted itself in the establishment of additional rules and in the clear establishment of a hierarchical subordination when you have the fourfold Sangha. The bhikkhus, the male monastics, are in the top, and then the bhikkhunis, and then the male lay people, and then the female lay people. Yeah. Now, because of the lesser status of the nuns, when the monastic life is extinguished in different areas of Buddhism, for instance in Sri Lanka or in Thailand, they were then not re-established. So they died out in all Theravada Buddhism and in Tibetan Buddhism too, the Tibetan tradition only knowing the lesser ordinations for the nuns still. And the only ordination line that kept the nun ordination is the Dharmaguptaka or the Vinaya in the Chinese tradition that received it in the 4th, 5th century from Sri Lanka and carried it then into a hybrid Mahayana context. Okay, so it's a Theravada, a Staviravada type of Vinaya that functions within a Mahayana context. Okay, just like the Mulasavatthivadi Vinaya in the Tibetan Buddhism is also Staviravada type, Stravakayana type, yeah. Vinaya functioning in the Mahayana tantric context. Now, so when we move on with the establishment of Mahayana, one of the simplified movements that we see always in the depiction of Buddhism about Mahayana is that, oh, all of a sudden Buddhism became universal again and embraced everybody and embraced women and lay people more, and that story is not completely accurate. Early Mahayana Buddhist texts can be extremely misogynistic, can be extremely monastically centered. So it's not all just about lay people and about women. But generally in the broad streams of Mahayana Buddhism, you find a variety of different attitudes towards gender equality that range from rejection to unequal acceptance to complete equal acceptance. And one litmus test here is the doctrinal question of whether for female birth it is necessary to be reborn a man in order to realize complete enlightenment. And the Theravada Orthodoxy, Southern Buddhism, completely agrees with that. Right? It is impossible, cannot be, that a woman should be an Arahant who is a Sammasambuddha. So for those who read Pali, there's Pali there. But many people don't know that also the Mahayana Buddhist majority adheres to this doctrinal stance. And it's only the minority of Mahayana Buddhism that look at sutras as such as the Gangotara Sutra, the Sagaranagaracha Sutra, the Namakipanidesha, Srimala Sarivishimanada Sutra, these kind of sutras, that actually say no. But this minority viewpoint of view is actually more in line with the early Buddhist evidence. So that's the interesting thing, you know. And again, for Tantric Buddhism, it's a little bit more complicated again. Now, this all on the, you could say, sociology is in a weird tension to the clear soteriology that says, well, oh, enlightenment is the letting go of all conceptualizations. All concepts fall away in the experience of enlightenment, and that includes gender. And there are actually teachings about the irrelevance of gender and gender binaries and gender hierarchies in Mahayana sutras, such as the Lotus Sutra, but also in Theravada texts, you know, in the commentaries on the Dhammapada, and on the mainly Shravakayana Abhidhamma Kosha. And I don't have probably time to go through this, especially the case of the Lotus Sutra is interesting because there's this instance that the 8-year-old Naga princess actually miraculously transformed herself into a male just before she goes into the enlightenment. So you can see that's a sort of compromise. Gender is irrelevant, but just because you have a real problem with me being a girl, I'll just transform, or I just perform maleness just before I relax into enlightenment. But that's not the case in other sutras, in other stories. And actually you find some really, really humorous stories about conservative, heteropatriarchally privileged monks being taught a lesson in the irrelevance of gender by females, such as in the case of the goddess in the Vimalakirti Nidesha Sutra, the goddess who is showing Shariputra that she can be just as enlightened as him, and so she miraculously switches place, and then she asks Shariputra, who has become a woman, oh, do you feel less enlightened now that you are a woman? So that's quite funny. Or other humorous episodes where Upagupta actually uses changing his own gender in order to teach a horny monk who cannot control his celibacy a lesson and give him a shock when Upagupta basically transforms himself into a beautiful girl. He's this old, rather ugly guy, and he transforms himself into a beautiful girl, and then this monk gets horny and starts making out with this girl and tries to rape her, and then Upagupta had enough of it and he transforms himself back, and then the guy gets a little bit of a shock, and so he shows them, so he uses gender fluidity to show that actually when you and Upagupta is an arahant, he is realized, is a realized master. So on the level of Buddhist realization, gender is just a concept, and if you're master of samsara, you're also master of gender. You can just switch, you know. And obviously this is then used in esoteric Buddhism clearly, you know, on this what Sponberg called a soteriological androgyny. Now I'll give you one example. The mainstream tantric practices that are being done in Tibetan Buddhism, they are usually composed from an androcentric point of view. So they assume the practitioner is a man and also a monk. But still, the practices themselves have this celibate man imagine themselves in the form of an aroused naked female who then goes on to have tantric intercourse with a male deity or male expression of a Buddhist of enlightenment. So that is in the highest tantric practices that you do in the curriculum at the latest stage of your meditation career. These are the practices that are directly transforming your mind towards enlightenment. You have this almost embodied experience of androgyny, yeah, or of switching gender. It's almost psychodrama, yeah. Imagining yourself in a different gender and then doing these kind of things. So, I talked about four false Alexandria, right? So, one of the things on how am I doing for time? Okay. So how long should I talk to? Quarter past? Quarter past. Okay, good. Okay, fine.
Be comfortable about it.
Oh, okay, so great. So one of the things where gendered, this idea that female is a subordinate gender is very prominent is the prophecies on the decline of the sasana, of the decline of the dispensation of Buddhism. And for many people in the contemporary discourses, be that in Thailand or in Sri Lanka, that's a very huge issue, theological or dharmological issue, that they use to hold back the reinstatement of the full ordination, the upasampada status for renunciates. So if we look at from the history now to a little bit on the current debates, then here we see the first extinction of the Buddhist nun order in the 11th century after the Chola invasion of Sri Lanka. And when a century later the monastic order was re-established, was only the male branch of it. Instead of that, what came also after the second extinction and second establishment were a lesser form of, or not canonical form of, female renunciates in the form of the Dasa Silmatas, the mothers of the ten Silas. And that was actually an interesting occurrence because it was done in the direct in direct negotiation of Buddhist colonial identity. So we find in the 18th, 19th centuries, we find in negotiating Buddhist Sinhalese identity in the background of Christian or especially Protestant criticism of Buddhism, we find a phenomenon what is called in Sri Lanka Protestant Buddhism, a sort of purging of Buddhism from hybridities and indigenous practices. And also you had then all of the sudden Western scholars who read the Pali Canon were really interested and enthused by the content, the soteriological content, and then they looked the highest metaphysics of Buddhism and compared it with the folk practice, sociology of Buddhism, and they saw a huge divide there. It's a little bit like I don't need to make a comparison with Christianity because we're not in a predominantly Christian context here. So, but this is what they found, and it's interesting that one of the things in Protestant Buddhism was a reestablishment of a place for female spirituality that is semi-recognized, but because of the extinction of the nun order, could not be called nuns or bhikkhunis. So we find this category of this in-between category of the Dasa Silmatas being important in Sri Lanka from similar groups in Burma. So we have the Mai Chis in Thailand, the Mai Shilas in Myanmar and Burma. Now, this is, why do I say that? Because it's, why do I mention that? Because I want to now have a look at what happens when the idealized value of gender equality is being tried to be put into an institutional practice again. And here, the real issue is now we have inequality already anyway. The bhikkhus are always better than the bhikkhunis, but now the bhikkhunis even don't exist. And instead we have even a step lower. These renunciates that are not recognized and they're not allowed to wear saffron robes. They're wearing white and so on. You know, and so the real issue then is being debated in the Sangha is, can the Bhikkhuni Sangha be re-established? And if it does it have to be re-established through dual or through single ordination? That means through an ordination by both Bhikkhunis and Bhikkhus, or it can actually a Bhikkhu, a male group, a monk group themselves establish, make somebody a Bhikkhuni. And then the problem of the different Vinaya tradition, and especially then the Dhammaguptaka being interpolated with Mahayana practices and so on. What is sociologically more interesting is these kind of debates create for lay people insecurities of whether supporting female renunciates actually is a valid form of accumulating merit. And you know, for Buddhist lay people, accumulating merit is the main practice in many Buddhist traditions. Not so much in the modernist traditions, but in the non-modernist Buddhist traditions, accumulating merit is the most important thing, and that is being done through the support of the sangha, of the monastics. So if the bhikkhunis are not real, then people say, well, I'd rather give my money to the monks. At least I know they're a field of merit, so I get my merit bank account is getting filled. With the nuns, you don't know. And that is the interesting thing, how bhikkhunis, even when they are ordained, are able to survive, whether lay people accept them or not. Now, you have also then the interpolation with politics and nationalism. Obviously, in Sri Lanka, just as in Thailand, the Buddhist orders are completely interpolated in state nationalism and state interests. So you have the Supreme Advisory Council of the Ministry of Buddhist Affairs, a very powerful organ in Sri Lanka that has been opposing and is still opposing the introduction of the re-establishment of the Theravada Bhikkhuni order. So this is just to give you an overview over the institutions that play a role. And so when the first five Sri Lankan Dasasya Matas actually ordained in California, nothing much happened. It was simply not recognized. It was a single ordination, and it was completely done by Dharmaguptaka monastics. So it was a dual ordination by Dharmaguptaka monastics. So it was simply not recognized. So basically, these bhikkhunis went back, and since they weren't recognized as bhikkhunis, they just continued working as Dasasya Matas. You know. That changed almost 10 years later. There was another attempt. Again, just Dharmaguptaka monks, in this case, Korean monks. And the real shift was in 1998, in Bodh Gaya, this huge ordination ceremony, because Chinese bhikkhunis and Theravada bhikkhus actually combined. And that was the huge argument to say, well, okay, the transmission of the Vinaya was done by the bhikkhus in the Theravada tradition, and the bhikkhunis holding the Dharmaguptaka were just supporting that. And in that sense, from there on, we find slowly a spread of the ordination, are still not recognized by the Sri Lankan Sangha. Very similar in Thailand. I think I'll skip that a little bit. It's quite a similar picture. You know, the picture didn't translate. That was one of the things that didn't go. So I'll just skip that. I'll just had something on the Thai situation. Very, very similar to Sri Lanka, actually. And still, state Buddhism simply does not accept. And you might have heard about this schism that actually occurred in the Ajahn Chah Thai Forest Sangha lineage. Yeah? I think this is another interesting example if we talk about transnational value productions. Here is a Western convert to the Thai Forest Sangha, who's a monk, has lived in Thailand in this tradition, has been recognized in this tradition as a major spiritual teacher, went back to Australia, established monasteries and so on. And he's also a scholar. He's a scholar of Pali, a scholar of early Buddhism. So he's not somebody who doesn't know better, you know. He's reading the texts and looking at these things and so on. And he studied the suttas and the vinayas very carefully, and he came to the decision, actually, there is no legal argument in the vinaya that would prohibit monks in bhikshus in single ordination, re-establishing the bhikshuni tradition. So that's what he did. He ordained four bhikshunis in 2009 and was then, by Thai state Buddhism, excommunicated to the effect that he's not allowed to enter Thailand anymore. Actually, that is the power of Thai state Buddhism, of the Thai Sangha. So that is some in Buddhist modernism, you could say he's a Buddhist modernist, somebody who's driving change that is not accepted in the local community in Thailand itself, in the mainstream there, is accepted in there are now bhikshunis also of his ordination also working in Thailand, but it's a very long process. And then there's this other model that you find in the Thai forest tradition as it is established in the UK, because the people in Chitthurst Buddhist Monastery, Amaravati Buddhist Monastery that belong to the Ajahn Chah forest tradition, they actually have decided not to go the full confrontative route and stick to a sort of a hybrid, newly invented form of a lower ordination that they call the Siladhara ordination, the 10 precept nuns that are similar to the Meichis in Thailand. Yeah? So here we find progressive and conservative forces, depending on which emphasis they lay on soteriology or on sociology. Well, Ajahn Chah actually is even questioning the hierarchical superiority of the bhikkhus over the bhikshunis, and so he's very very radical and very progressive. So it's quite interesting. It's very interesting. Now going from a little bit from this exemplification of gender equality versus gender inequality in Buddhist traditions. Back to gender identity and sexuality, and still staying in the monastic theme, what is interesting to see is and to realize is people, when they look at Buddhism and Buddhist value productions, they often muddle two things. They look at the Vinaya and think, well, oh, this is what Buddhist ethics is. The Vinaya is not Buddhist ethics. Vinaya is the code for monastics. That's a huge difference, okay? It's more or less a sociological code, the code for an institution. If you want to be a monastic, then you follow the Vinaya. But it does not give you a normative ethics. Buddhist ethics is virtue ethics, and it differs for lay people and for ordained people. Why? Because as an ordained person, you follow a certain institutional road and you vow to do so. So you have a speech act that is very performative, a vow, and through this speech act, you actually declare an intention. When you break the vow, it's not just the act of what you're doing that is detrimental, but it is the breaking of the vow. You say, in other words, you say you are going to do something and then you don't do it, or you break your word. So that's very different than people saying, well, oh, look at the Vinaya and things are forbidden. No, they are forbidden in a very clear context when you take the vows. So if you don't take the vows, you're of course not bound to it. What you're bound to it is virtues. And virtues are contextualized always. No? Now, in the context of this institutional, of the institution of the monastics of the Vinaya, you see that that one of the ideas for the Sangha was to be free of gossip, to be free of stain. So actually, in the cultural context of the establishment of the Sangha, we find Vinaya texts that say, well, as a monk, you have to stay away from sex workers. You have to stay away from widows and spinsters. you have to stay away from panda cars, which are is the third sex/gender category. I'll come to that later. And also, you should stay away from nuns. So why is that? No, not because these people are essentialized, terrible people, but because their reputation in society, that conversing with them could be constructed as you actually breaking your vows, that breaking that what you say to do, that you say to be a celibate. If you're a monk and you're in the company of sex workers all the time, people will start gossiping, and that's the thing. People gossip, and then you have a problem, right? At the other hand, the early Buddhists co-monastic course never made a big deal out of it if there was the case that, for instance, a monk all of a sudden decided or realized that they were a woman and not a man. Yeah. So in the South Asian context, I've published on that, I don't want to go into the arguments on it, but if you see the older Hindu texts and the Jain texts and the Buddhist texts, you see there was an accepted that you could say your gender identity could simply change like that, because everything is subject to samsara, to fluidity, to change, impermanence. So as the texts here say, if the sign of a woman or a sign of a man appears in a woman or in a man, it's the opposite sect, the Buddha was very, very laconic. It's not a big deal. We just have to deal with it pragmatically. So what's the pragmatic answer? Okay, if there's a monk and the sign of a woman appears in him, then she is now a nun and should follow the nun rules. It's as simple as that. You know, so there is institutionally a wide spiel of once you're ordained of dealing with issues around gender identity, and then I'm not going to talk about that in today very much, but if you then look how this argument is being used or can be used for the acceptance of gender variable people into the Sangha, that is the basic, the theological or dharmological basic from which you can argue for transgender inclusion, for inclusion of Katois in Thailand, and so on. Anyway, I just wanted to mention that. Now, I mentioned the Chatushkoti, I'm not going to do it. Now, what is interesting again, that the so-called third gender, the Pandakars, is very often in modern discourse, if you look at in Thailand, so Pandakar is always translated, is in colonial times translated as eunuch. But it's now in the modern discourse used as a synonym for homosexual. But the South Asian context constructs pandaka as the neither male nor female. And that is actually, if you see these 4th century definitions of pandaka, of types of pandaka, has to do with either impotence, somebody who cannot eject semen or has periods of impotence, or some sort of sexual behavior, the voyeuristic behavior, fetish behavior, or passive homosexual behavior. So it's either has to do with a lack of maleness. That's what the word actually means etymologically. Yeah. So lack of maleness, neither male nor female. So it's a very different thing than our modern 19th-20th century concept of the homosexual as an identity. As an identity category, so it's not really a good fit for arguing exclusion of certain types of minorities from ordination or even from being part of the Sangha, although it's being done. It's conservative discourse in Thailand and Sri Lanka basically translate pandaka into what in the West is now called homosexual. Yeah. So it's not really like that. And if we then now talk about sexuality again, just reminding you on that, is that from a virtue ethics point of view, the Buddhist baseline has always simply been the avoidance of misconduct in sexual matters. And what that means is always contextual. The Buddha himself in the suttas only gives three examples or three parameters for what misconduct is. Incest, coercion, so rape or assault, or a violation of status. A status could be marriage or could be ordination. Right? These three fields. And this is what he calls misconduct. Right? If you use force, if you commit incest, or you violate somebody's status. That's it. Celibacy is just a vow for monks and nuns. Yeah? And sometimes, you know, at certain occasions, lay people would take the vow of celibacy for a day, or for when they go into retreat for a week, or for 2 weeks, and so on. And then this is for this period, you know? And that's it. Now, if you look at these celibacy vows and how it then deals with the breaches, then we look at how sexuality is then hierarchized, we find a very heteropatriarchal, heterosexual view on sexual breaches with focus on avoiding of procreative dependencies. In other words, monks were endangering the sangha when they were being intimate with a woman and siring children, right? As that's what the Catholic Church is dealing with. Right? They're paying a lot of alimonies to priests who are supposed to be celibate, but they make children and so on. You know, it's a reliability for the sangha. So the harshest punishment is for vaginal intercourse. You know, we don't have contraception in this time. You risk making a baby, right? So that is the full breach of celibacy. The other breaches of celibacy, they are less severe. They're still severe, and they're severely punished, but less severe. But they are more looked at not so much as a danger for the community, but they show your immaturity towards working with desire, with sensual desire. Yeah? And anything that has to do with ejaculation or with orgasm is a clear show that you're immature. The closer it is to the procreative intercourse, the more the severe it is. What's interesting is that intragender sexuality, monks who have sex with other monks, is not stigmatized in a bigger way, in a stronger way than monks who have sex with a female. Not at all. Actually, it's less stigmatized. So. Because, yeah, you're immature and you can't keep your pants zipped up, but at least you're not risking making a baby, right? So there is not this kind of stigma of intragender sexuality as something that is completely, in itself, essentialized wrong. No. It's an interesting thing. Well, and there is... For nuns who have sex with other females or nuns, there is not so much the same sort of awareness for lesbian sex, you could say, as there is for men who have sex with men. And that is a little bit in a contradiction to this idea, Indian idea, is that the females are the real predatory, and they go around and they all they want is sex, you know, it's mine. But then again, the Vinaya doesn't really talk about much, at least, about intragender desire between females. Anyway, what interested me, and I recently published an article on that, is if we talk about value production now in sexualities, is how does it come that specific sexual offenses that we find in long stories in the Vinaya, in the context of the Vinaya, but never in the context of lay people in early Buddhism, how does that enter an ethical code for lay people all of a sudden? And what you see in the textual evidence, is that it only enters Buddhism in the 4th century Common Era. And that is at least 800 years after the inception of Buddhism. And it is the time after after a prolonged cultural influence from Central Asia on the Indian subcontinent in the Kushana Empire. And we know that in this period, the Gupta period, a lot of the value production that come from the Central Asian Kushana have been starting to materialize. We see that in Hindu texts, we see this in Buddhist texts, that all of a sudden there is a sort of Puritanism emerging and re-emerging, and you could say that it's quite likely that this is Kushana influence. We find in this time, for the first time, actually that a sort of sexual code that is not just for breach of celibacy for monks and nuns, but that is valid also for lay men and women, is being propagated. And it's being propagated basically through three traditions that I, as far as I could identify. The most known one is in Southern Buddhism, that's the last one on the board, Buddhaghosa's and the Pali Theravada commentary tradition, especially the influential Buddhaghosa's influential commentary on the Digha Nikaya, where sexual ethics all of a sudden comes from a sociological organization of an institution to an almost normative ethical rule book. Yeah? The other one is also Shravakayana Buddhist in the Abhidhamma Kosha, and its commentary by Vasubandhu. And this has been then widely received in the Indic, both Shravakayana and Mahayana traditions, and also the Tibetan tradition. But one of the traditions that I identified, I think, as the first working on this area, and that has been overlooked so far, is actually the tradition of the Yogacara Bhumi Shastra. And the reason I think it has been overlooked is that in its totality, the Yogacara Bhumi Shastra is not extant anymore in Sanskrit. There are huge parts of it of Sanskrit, but the ethical parts are only there in Chinese translation. So people usually, they looked at Pali and Sanskrit text, but they didn't know Chinese, so they didn't look there, and they didn't find the text there. So, and this is actually very, very interesting, because we find here, again, very early, about first half, 4th century, a tradition that is formative for East Asia, for whole East Asia, and including this part of wherever Chinese and Sea Chinese went, you know, wherever Mahayana Buddhism spread, Korea, Japan, everywhere, you know. Now, if we look at this tradition especially, then you find in this part of the Yogacara Bhumi Shastra a categorization, therefore, for sexual ethics, for lay people, that explicitly for the first time, so in the early 4th century Common Era, says that any sexual act you commit with a man, in Chinese it says no man, that is the tradition of the translation of pandaka, or a pandaka, is called improper practice. Improper practice is basically a Chinese synonym for sexual misconduct. That's what the in Chinese text is for mityachara in Sanskrit, or mityachara in Pali, improper practice. And that is then being propagated through normative commentary, especially the Brahmajala commentary, which is basically the foundational East Asian code book for morality. Yeah, that's the commentary by Daehyun, a famous Korean monk, who you are probably aware what we do in Buddhism in Buddhist philology when we are the commentaries work like that they give a text where they include the root text. So in order to mark that, we put the root text in bold. But this is where we are. I don't think I gave the complete Chinese text. I just gave the. So you see here, this anything with men and pandakas, which is the root text, is being expanded. It's being explained here in the commentarial literature and enters East Asian cultural consciousness. The huge taboo of transgender desire comes ultimately, as far as Buddhism is concerned, from the Yogacara Bhumichastra tradition. So it's quite interesting where it comes from here. Now you have a similar thing for the Abhidhamma Kosha, which was much more productive than in the Tibetan tradition. What is interesting here was what the Bandhu is. He clears what is unbodily, Anange, Anange Vaji Gachati Swamapi Bhavya Mapani Nukeva. So he, as he says, sex with mouth and with anal sex, oral sex, is immoral, is unbodily. So, it's improper. And that's a Blanco thing. He doesn't actually differentiate gender. But the commentaries do again. Again, it's not the Abhidhamma Kosha itself, not Vasubandhu. It's just implied. He forbids certain practices, and then the commentaries would, in the Tibetan tradition, be very, very clear about this. So, for instance, Gampopa, there was a companion in the Kamakaju lineage, a really important one. And you can see is actually what he's doing, he's paraphrasing Abhidhamma Kosha, but he explicates. That's always how these traditions work. They are explicating. This is a paraphrasis of Abhidhamma Kosha with an explication of that it is. We first only had oral and anal. And Gampopa adds rape and intragender and male pandaka, because pandaka being a different. So that's also the funny thing about people now saying pandaka is gay or is homosexual, because clearly these texts say, well, a pandaka is a completely different separate category, but they actually acknowledge that also two men can have sex, not just so two men having sex doesn't make it necessarily one man a pandaka. Right? So that's quite interesting. Okay. There's a whole part of the paper that I'm not going into, but I just want to show how different in modernist Buddhism and Buddhist modernism now, how these kind of questions have become areas of interest in socially engaged Buddhism. Now, what I'm not going to do is what I prepared to do, and I didn't know really how much of time I would have and how much I waffle, so I apologize for talking so long. But there are two little case studies I could talk about in Asia and in transnational Buddhism, how different streams of Buddhism actually engage with arguments around gender equality and sexual equality or sexual liberation. I'm not going to do that. But as you can see from the picture I'm painting, this is a very complex and very, very diverse field. And you can find within Buddhisms, the fundamentalists, just right-wing fundamentalists, just like the left left wing, you could say, progressive liberation theologians, dharmologians, and so on. And it's a really interesting field to see, to locate your local Buddhist movement or group or tradition in these different streams of pre-modern, modern, and post-modern negotiations of value productions around gender and sexuality. Thank you very much for listening.